Hello friends, good morning to all of you. Welcome to EPG Padashala. I am going to discuss about programs for potential and habitual offenders. A habitual offender or career criminal is a person convicted of a new crime who was previously convicted of a crime. Various state and jurisdictions may have laws targeting habitual offenders and specifically providing for enhanced or exemplary punishments or either sanctions. Comprehensive crime prevention programs must include effective measures to prevent recidivism and to stop the cycle of failed adaptation by repeat offenders. Offenders released from confinement face a variety of challenges that may hinder their ability to become law-abiding citizens. Of particular concern are high-risk offenders with lengthy records of criminality. A key feature of successful crime prevention strategies is the attention to the social reintegration of ex-prisoners into the community and the development of interventions designed to reduce the level of recidivism. These interventions represent a wide array of efforts sponsored by the justice system, often in collaboration with community agencies and organizations. Offender reintegration programs target the dynamic risk factors associated with recidivism, and specific initiatives focus on specific challenges facing offenders, including substance abuse and unemployment. While others target specific offender groups, including sex offenders and high-risk young offenders. Offenders reintegration programs can be generally grouped into prison-based programs, surveillance-based transition programs, assistance-based transition programs, and integrated through CRARP programs. To date, there have been few rigorous evaluations that would be facilitate the identification of best practices and provide definitive conclusions as to the efficiency of specific interventions. From the limited evaluations that have been conducted, however, it is possible to identify several key features of interventions that appear to be effective in assisting offenders to reintegrate in the community and to impact on re-offending. These programs provide a continuum of assistance from the incarceration stage to the release stage and beyond, and involve close collaboration between justice and social service, health and other agencies, the offender's family and community-based organizations. It is important that the development of interventions designed to facilitate the social reintegration of offenders and reduce the rates of reoffending be informed by the efforts and outcomes of programmatic initiatives undertaken to date. This overview of current practices was prepared to set out some of the primary lessons that can inspire and guide practitioners in designing measures and strategies that are adapted to their circumstances. The overview concludes with a number of practical considerations that should be considered in planning future interventions. Successful crime prevention strategies must address factors contributing to the large number of crimes that are committed by individuals who have served a term of incarceration and failed upon their release. To integrate the community as law-abiding citizens, in the absence of material, psychological and social support at the time of their release, offenders may have a very difficult time breaking the cycle of release and re-arrest. Short-term prison terms and extended terms of remand in custody provide limited opportunities for successful treatment and interventions to prevent future recidivism. A majority of convicted offenders have at least one prior conviction either in youth or adult court, and among recidivists nearly one-third have a prior conviction and nearly 75% have multiple prior convictions. Community safety makes it imperative that governments and communities develop effective interventions that will assist ex-prisoners to successfully reintegrate into the community and avoid further criminality. Managed offender reentry processes and programs are gaining acceptance and may offer a cost-effective way of preventing crime. There is therefore an increasing focus among policymakers and practitioners on identifying programs and strategies that will help prisoners successfully reintegrate back into their communities without re-offending. There is no consensus as to whether ex-offender re-entry support programs are effective in assisting reintegration and reducing the rates of recidivism. To date, there have been few evaluation of existing programs. Many of the current initiatives were developed on the basis of somewhat conflicting program evaluation findings in related correctional areas. Example, impact of drug treatment, employment training, counseling and community supervision. While there is an abundance of ideas as to what in theory should work, the finding of program evaluations are often disconcerting. Further, the majority of reintegration programs have not been subjected to controlled evaluations, and successful approaches remain to be identified and articulated. Often, research and practice seem to move on separate tracks. As the following will reveal, there is some evidence that positive reintegration outcomes are attained when factors predisposing a person to criminal behavior are addressed in a holistic fashion, and when the physical and social needs of offenders are supported both within the prison and after the offenders. Nevertheless, facilitating offender reintegration is a complex task, and the impact of specific interventions is often difficult to measure. The crime prevention goal of these programs is measured in terms of offender recidivism, a measure that is in itself problematic. Estimating recidivism rates is influenced by how and when reoffending is measured. As well, recidivism may be measured at different points of a known offender's contact with the criminal justice system. The Habitual Offender Act provides for enhanced punishment for those convicted of a misdemeanor or high misdemeanor if they have been convicted of an high misdemeanor on one or more prior occasions. An individual with a single prior high misdemeanor conviction is subject for a subsequent conviction to a sentence twice the maximum which could have been imposed had the later offense been his first. A third offender is exposed to a sentence three times as severe as that provided for the latest conviction, and a fourth offender is thereby declared to be an habitual criminal and a sentence one for any term of years or for life may be imposed. For the purposes of this act, convictions of several prior high misdemeanors changed in one indictment or accusation, or in two or more indictments or accusations consolidated for trial, or considered as only one conviction. Constitutionality of the act. Habitual offender laws in this state as well as in other jurisdictions have been challenged on numerous grounds, generally without success. In 1901, the United States Supreme Court upheld the constitutionality of a Massachusetts residuist statute in McDonald versus Massachusetts. The court held that the statute in question imposed an increased punishment upon the latest crime of a prior offender rather than any additional punishment for the former crimes. It therefore was not an ex post facto law and did not put the accused twice in jeopardy for the same offense. The statute was also held not to deny a defendant the equal protection of the laws and not to impose a cruel or unusual punishment. The Supreme Court has reaffirmed these conclusions in subsequent cases. Challenges confronting offenders at the time of their release, offenders confined in the correctional institutions are confronted by a range of social, economic, and personal challenges that tend to become obstacles to a crime-free lifestyle. Some of these challenges are a result of offenders' past experiences, and others are more directly associated with the consequences of incarceration and the following difficult transition back to the community. Offenders may have a history of social isolation and marginalization, physical or emotional abuse, poor employment and unemployment, and involvement in a criminal lifestyle that began at an early age. So too may offenders be challenged by physical and mental disabilities and health issues that may be related to substance abuse and drug addiction. Many offenders are challenged by skills deficits that make it difficult for them to compete and succeed in the community. Poor interpersonal skills, low level of formal education, illiteracy or innumeracy, poor cognitive or emotional functioning, and or a lack of planning and financial management skills. There are also several practical challenges that must be faced by offenders at the time of their release, including finding suitable accommodation with very limited means, managing financially with little or no savings until they begin to earn some lawful remuneration, accessing a range of everyday necessities, and assessing services and support for their specific needs. The period of transition from custody to community can be particularly difficult for offenders and contribute to the stress that is associated with being supervised in the community. The period of incarceration may itself have several collateral effects. They may have lost their livelihood, their personal belongings, their ability to maintain housing for themselves and their family. They may have lost important personal relationship, and incarceration may have damaged their social networks. They may have experienced mental health difficulties or acquired self-defeating habits and attitudes. Homelessness in particular may place youth at risk of offending. The failed re-entry of prisoners into society involves some significant costs for society, both financial and in terms of public society. The costs of program to support the reintegration of offenders must be assessed against the benefits of avoiding these significant failures, social and financial costs. Next, risk factors. The primary criminogenic needs that must be addressed by institutional and community-based treatment services are related to education, employment, accommodation, drugs and alcohol, mental health, social networks, cognitive skills and attitudes. These risk factors are dynamic, meaning they are amenable to change, whereas other risk factors are not. Program evaluations in the UK have identified a number of interventions that reduce risk factors. These include preschool education, family literacy, parenting information and support, reasoning and social skill education, organizational change in schools, and reading schemes. Treatment programs vary in efficacy and none are completely effective. Interventions can fail to achieve their objectives because not all offenders are immediately amenable to treatment. A lack of willingness to accept responsibility or poor motivation to change can make a big difference. Among the obstacles to youth engagement in education, training and employment are high levels of non-participation by youth. A lack of knowledge of the issues among professionals and conflicting objectives and target among programs. Those offenders who complete treatment programs have higher rates of success in terms of their successful reintegration. Factors associated with treatment completion include more years of education, not having a history of sexual victimization, fewer previous incarceration, lower level of minimization of justification of the offending behavior. Programs are typically developed on the basis of the current understanding of the dynamic risk factors associated with recidivism. The typical needs of offenders and the challenges they encounter upon their release from prison. Programs vary according to the recidivism risk factors and the type of social integration challenges they are designed to address. Many programs focus on specific challenges confronting offenders, such as addiction, drug abuse, or unemployment, and many offender reintegration programs have been designed to deal with specific categories of offenders, such as chronic offenders, drug addicted offenders, young offenders, mentally ill offenders, or dangerous sexual offenders. Traditionally, one could identify three main types of offenders reintegration programs. Institution-based programs, that is, some of them offered by community-based agencies, surveillance-based transition programs, assistance-based transition programs. We will review each one of these briefly, as none of these type of interventions in themselves seems to produce satisfactory results in terms of reducing future recidivism. This will serve as an introduction to be a brief of presentation of some of the most promising forms of interventions designed thus far. Integrated and thorough care programs for offender reintegration. Institutional programs designed to prepare offender to re-enter society can include education, mental health care, substance abuse treatment, job training, counseling and mentoring. These programs are more effective when they are centered on a full diagnostic and assessment of offenders. Some of these programs are offered prior to the release by community-based agency, which are equipped to provide aftercare and follow-up with the offenders following their release from confinement. Effective institutional programs tend to focus on a number of dynamic risk factors and offenders' challenges or needs that require attention in order to prepare the offender for release and a successful reintegration. As these programs are voluntarily, a large number of offenders do not participate and are subsequently released into the community without any pre-release preparation. Parole and other conditional release decisions are often based on whether an offender has participated in programs designed to address some of his or her criminogenic needs or other challenges. Effective readiness for release, however, is difficult to assess. Some institutionality based drug treatment programs delivered by the Correctional Service of Canada appear to have a significant impact on the rate of recidivism following release, particularly those that are followed by assistance care support during the aftercare period. Participants who complete their substance abuse program have higher rates of recidivism, decreased up by to 50%. Many practitioners in the treatment and social reintegration fields acknowledge that reintegration support interventions should link institutional services without community-based services. There is, however, little evidence that interventions that merely refer offenders to community-based service effectively assist in the reintegration process. Providing referrals rather than substantive aftercare is generally ineffective. Rather, there must be linkages between institutional programming and community-based interventions to ensure continuity of support. Conclusions. As indicated above that habitual offender is rarely invoked, the Act in its form vests complete discretion in the trial court as to both its innovation and the sentences imposes pursuant to it. Thus, there is likelihood for an increase in its utilization as it now stands. Before the Act is modified, a legislative nation should he made training criminal sentencing in general and the purpose of and goals of offender law. The duties and responsibilities of the prosecutor and with respect to recidivist sentencing should he clearly establishing and of the present law should reflect those determinations. Thank you.